What's up, guys? Welcome to another episode of Scotty Talks Philly Sports. It's your boy Scotty here. I'm downstairs today. I got my Christmas tree behind me. We got Black Santa above me. You know, just really feeling the holiday spirit. We're coming into the matchup with the Browns this weekend, obviously. You know, Eagles aren't looking good. 3-5-1, not where we want to be at, you know, in a weak division like the NFC East. But, you know, we got a big matchup with the Browns, a must win if we're being completely honest. We got a 5-game stretch here that is just brutal, and we can't afford to lose to a team like the Browns. But I'm welcoming a very special guest, my good friend Rod, that I've met over Twitter. He's a Cleveland Brown fan, but also a podcast host of the Browns Blitz. Be sure to go check out that page and check out the podcast. Be sure to give them a subscription. It's a really good guy, and he's got some really good content over there. You can find them at the Brown Blitz on Twitter. You can also find his personal page at CleRodB. So yeah, just enjoy this episode with my good buddy Rod. Of course, remember to subscribe and like the channel. We're building, we're growing, and I got some big giveaways coming up, so be sure to get a part of that. But yeah, just remember to give us a follow at ST Philly Sports 1 on Twitter and Instagram, and you can find my personal page at Scotty Drown. Enjoy the episode, guys. All right, welcome to another episode of Scotty Talks Philly Sports. I'm welcomed by a very special guest, my good friend I met over Twitter, an actual Browns fan. I don't have any Browns fans as friends, so this will be nice and interesting. His name is Rod Bluhm. He is the host of the Browns Blitz podcast. And you can find that Twitter. They got their own Twitter page on Twitter. And you can find them at the Browns Blitz with a Z, of course. And you can find Rod on Twitter at CleRodB. That is CleRod with a capital B. Welcome to the show, Rod. How's it going, man?
It's going good, Scotty. Thanks for having me.
No problem at all, man. Let's start the show out. It's not often that, you know, you have an Eagles fan interacting with a Browns fan. We don't have a rivalry or anything crazy like that. So that's why I wanted to get you on the show and kind of, you know, just introduce the Cleveland Browns to the people that like to, you know, listen about Philly sports. So, yeah, Rod, just tell us, you know, how long you've been a Cleveland fan and kind of what got you into Cleveland, and are you from there? What's going on with you, Rod?
I'm from Cleveland. I live in Dayton right now. It's about three and a half hours southwest of Cleveland. But yeah, born and raised in Cleveland, so I've been a Browns fan most of my life. So long time. So I go back to the days of you know, when the Browns were in the AFC Championship games, you know, with all the titles, which, you know, those are kind of the glory, but not the glory days. You know, it's kind of the teams we go back to and talk about, because really the last time the Browns were really good.
Yeah.
But you know, even though the games didn't turn out very well for the Browns, you know, a lot of beloved players from that era. So
of course,
you know, I've pretty much been a Browns fan since 1979, 1980, wow, right around that era. So saw some of the almost great days and lived through a lot of rough days since the Browns have come back.
But hey, so that's actually the good news of this episode for you. You know, as a Browns fan, you guys actually seem, you know, to be turning the corner. You guys got some, you know, really good talent on the team. And, you know, you guys are sitting at 6-3. Pretty good start to the season. You know, you've beat some teams that the Eagles have lost to, just, you know, to put it in comparison to one another. And, you know, you're in a tough division, probably, you know, one of the toughest, if not, you know, it's probably right there between you guys at the AFC North and then, you know, the NFC West over there. So, you know, you got the Ravens, the Steelers in your conference, obviously two teams that are up there right now. You guys are tied for second in the division, I believe. It's 6-3. Right. And then, of course, the Bengals round everything out at the bottom. So, yeah, just kind of if you want to just, you know, break down, how are you feeling about the Browns so far this season?
You know, Scotty, I think with the new coach, another new regime, it seems like in Cleveland we've gone through this every year or two for the past 20 years. So I think what a lot of us wanted was just for somebody to come in and kind of get things solidified and kind of start to see some progress. And we wanted to see a coach and a GM who could stick around for long enough to actually put something together. You know, to me, it's not even realistic to expect somebody to come in 1 year and take a team to the playoffs or even talk about winning some kind of title.
Yeah.
You know, you got to get in and start building something. So for me, I figured with, especially the way this season started, you know, with no preseason games and very limited, training camp and everything, I thought it would take the Browns a few games to get going. And, you know, they looked really bad their first game against the Ravens. I mean, It's the Ravens and the Browns come in cold, you know.
Right.
All these new guys, no practice, no preseason, and they get their butts kicked.
Right.
So, it was, you know, to me that was understandable. I just kind of wrote that game off. But since then, the next, I think, three games, they played really well.
Yeah.
So they started a lot faster than I thought they would. I figured it would take them more games to kind of gel and for Stefanski to get his systems in place and get the players, ready to go and install, enough of his plays to, to really get the team moving.
Right.
But it happened faster than we thought. So, you know, then all of a sudden you're changing expectations. So then, you got a team I was hoping they would, I was hoping for 8-8, maybe 9-7 because of the talent.
Right.
Thinking that's, all these new players, new coaches, plus the circumstances, I didn't want to expect too much this year.
Right.
So now they start off better. So you're hoping, maybe they can go 10-6. Maybe if they pick up an extra one somewhere, maybe they can go 11-5. Maybe they can make the playoffs. Maybe they can win a game in the playoffs. But to me, they're a year ahead of schedule.
Yeah,
they really are. Because to me, they addressed the offense in the past off season. They addressed the offensive line. They brought in. They brought in some guys on offense. They really didn't do much on defense. And
right.
I think they're planning on addressing defense, in the next offseason.
Right.
So whatever they do this year is kind of a bonus. That's kind of how I see it. So I'm very pleased with what they've done. I like what Stefanski's done. I love Andrew Berry. Thank you guys for letting us have him back.
Yeah, man, I actually love that guy too. He's a really good
player. You guys have a great GM in Howie, and I think Andrew Berry, I think he was good when he was in Cleveland, but definitely spending time with Howie, I'm sure helped him a lot too.
Yeah.
So,
and you
definitely see that too. So, I'm really happy with where they are.
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't blame you. I mean, 6-3 in that division is pretty good, to start the first half of the season. If you can just mimic that somewhat, you're going to have, 10 wins. So, 10 wins usually gets you in the playoffs for the most part. And at the end of the day, like you said, if you're feeling a year ahead of schedule, then making the playoffs is a pretty great accomplishment this year. You get Baker in there, get some experience, and that's kind of what it's all about.
Yeah, it's been 2002 is the last time the Browns made the playoffs.
And what era was that? Because I do remember the, Braylon Edwards era, so that might have been a little bit after 2002.
That was before that. That was Tim Couch. That was Kelly Holton playing for Tim Couch against Pittsburgh when Kelly Holcomb had the big game in Pittsburgh.
Gotcha. Kelly Holcomb,
but the Browns still lost the game. Browns had some guys on that team, but And that's pretty much it. The Browns went 10-6 in 2007, and they missed the playoffs.
Right. Right.
That those two seasons, that's been it since 1999.
Crazy, man. It's crazy. But, you know, if you guys do get the chance to make the playoffs this year, then you guys deserve it. You know what I mean? It's been long awaited. So you guys do deserve it. So kind of just, you know, talking about the Browns and, you know, kind of just going through the season here. I looked at some of the games. Like you said, you had a tough outing against the Ravens. That's kind of expected. They were coming in. You know, the Ravens were looking – some were saying the best team in the NFL at the time. And, you know, you took a hard loss there, but you bounced back with three wins in a row. Might have even been four in a row. So I'm looking at the Bengals, Washington, Dallas, and then the Colts. So yeah. I know you guys won those. Especially being the Colts, I think that was a pretty impressive win. So you kind of have had some highs and lows this season, because then after that, you know, you drop one to Pittsburgh, you know, was a tough outing, which Pittsburgh obviously is undefeated right now. That's not, you know, a bad loss necessarily. But then you drop one to Las Vegas. So, like, during those ups and downs, what have you noticed the difference between some of those games and just how the team is playing? Were those games, you know, because from the outside looking in, just based off, you know, like I said, I don't have a lot of familiarity with the Browns. So outside looking in, you know, they've been very run dependent. You know, Kevin Stefanski has looked to establish the run. And then, you know, if you need Baker to make some plays, he can usually make some plays, get out of the pocket and do some things for you. So what have you noticed between some of those games? Is it just that the Ravens and Steelers maybe were just too good, or maybe it was too much pressure being a division game?
Well, you know, I just think the Browns weren't ready week one for the Ravens. I really didn't expect the Browns to, you know, to do that well week one. I kind of figured that was kind of like their preseason game, you know, with the new coach and everything.
Right.
Not making excuses, but you're going up against a team that was like, what, 14-2 last season?
With the
playing them at home.
Yeah.
You barely practiced, and you got a new coach and all this stuff. So, you know, I expected them to lose the game. You know, they got whomped pretty good. You know, I was hoping they would make it a little bit closer, but you know, that game just didn't go well. So that's just how it is. The Pittsburgh game was the first game without Nick Chubb.
Right.
So Nick Chubb and Wyatt Teller weren't playing in that game. And the Browns had a couple things didn't go their way early in that game. And you know how a game can be in the NFL.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm not going to take anything away from Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh beat them up and down the field, but in that game, man, just a couple things went so bad early that the Browns were behind eight ball so bad that it took them out of their game. I think the Browns can play with Pittsburgh a whole lot better than they actually did.
Than what they did, right? You
know? So, it's just. That was just a tough game, and that game was in Pittsburgh. As far as the Raiders game, you know, that's a game people will tell you the Browns should have won, but the Raiders beat the Browns at their own game. The Raiders came in, ran the ball in the cold and sloppy weather,
right,
which is what the Browns should have been able to do to beat a West Coast team.
Right.
So you got to give the Raiders credit. The Browns should have been able to win that game, but the Browns lost the battle in the trenches that day, and I really don't know why, because I think the Browns should have been better than the Raiders on those lines.
Right.
But Josh Jacobs had a heck of a game, and their offensive line, he got their offensive line fired up, and they were knocking the Browns defensive line around, and you know, they got enough going to score enough points to win. I mean, that was a weather game. Just the weather had a huge impact on that game, and the Raiders handled it better than the Browns did.
Right.
Which is surprising, but you know, but it happened.
The Raiders aren't a bad team this year. So that's not really a bad loss, you know, if you look at who else the Raiders have been able to take down. I mean, the Chiefs, the Saints.
So, you know, that's not a terrible loss.
They've been in almost every game, I think, too. So, they're a talented team.
Yeah, they got something brewing there in Las Vegas. But so coming, you know, into the game against the Eagles, obviously the Eagles are 3-5-1. It's been a, you know, or they might even be 3-6-1 now, actually. No, they're 3-5-1.
3-5-1.
Yeah, they're 3-5-1. So obviously, you know, things have not gone the way that, you know, Eagles fans may have expected. You know, we're in a pretty bad division. So to have a losing record, even at that, you know, at that extent is, you know, pretty bad. So just coming into this game, I guess I just want to get, you know, maybe three of your strengths and, you know, strengths for the Browns, and then maybe three weaknesses that you see that might have an effect in the game against the Birds.
I had to think about this a little bit, but the three strengths I've got are the for the Browns, you know, maybe two of these go together, but would be the Browns offensive line and the running backs, you know, so definitely Nick Chubb and Kareem Hunt, and the Browns offensive line's healthy now with Wyatt Teller out there and all the other guys. They've got all five starters on the offensive line out there, and if the Browns get that ground game going, right, you know, it can be hard to stop with those guys.
Yeah.
So those are two of the strengths, and the other strength is Myles Garrett.
Yeah.
he's been a one-man wrecking crew, you know, creating turnovers, punishing quarterbacks. So
I saw he had 9.5 sacks. Yeah, so he's been
fun to watch. He really has.
Got to be a defensive MVP candidate. He has to be.
Yeah, he has. He's lived up to it. You know, he signed the extension in the offseason, and he's earning his money. I can tell you that much. As far as weaknesses, I'm going to say it's the Brown linebacking core, almost the entire linebacking core. It's the Browns. It's the linebacking core and the DBs. You know, save Denzel Ward.
Yeah, yeah.
Who's playing very well. So, you know, so he's going to probably do his best to take one of your wide receivers out of the game, or you know, at least maybe not completely, but he's come close to shutting down some pretty good players this year.
Yeah, he's an elite. He's an elite corner.
Yeah, the other weakness I think on the Browns is really just their youth and inexperience. They're still one of the younger teams in the league.
Gotcha. Yeah. So, I like what you said there. The strengths that you pointed out are literally what I'm most worried about. The Eagles are coming out of a game. You know, they just lost to the Giants, who was another 2-7 team. You know, a team that you would think we shouldn't lose. I mean, from Eagles' perspective, we think we shouldn't lose that game. They played us tough. We played really bad. And they ran the ball on us. And I think that was the thing that worries me most about coming into this game is, being an Eagles fan and watching the Birds the last couple of years, the one strong suit of our defense has been the run game. Mm-hmm. And this year, it has not been the same. We struggled against the run this year, and we've gotten exposed against guys that are not as nearly talented as Nick Chubb, Kareem Hunt, and those guys back there. So that tandem is worrisome, to say the least. And then of course we've had our offensive line issues, especially against pressure. So Richardson and Myles Garrett, those guys down there. That's definitely the biggest worry on the offensive end for us as well, I would say.
You guys have given up a lot of sacks, like 36 sacks, like almost 4 sacks a game. That's a bunch. I have to apologize to you and I think everybody in Philly, because I started the Eagles defense in fantasy last week. So I'm going to take I got to take some of the blame for the loss.
Hey, but it's crazy because going into that game, you just don't expect. I mean, Daniel Jones was nearly perfect. We weren't able. Our defensive line was getting pressured,
And I don't know if you know this about the Eagles, but the Eagles have put in so much money into that defensive line, bringing over Hargrave from Pittsburgh, paid him a bunch of money. We already had a bunch of money invested in Fletcher Cox and Brandon Graham. And, you know, for the most part, those guys do their part. It's just the, you know, the other guys that just get totally overwhelmed. And a lot of the times you're able to double team Fletcher Cox and then nobody else takes advantage of it. That's probably been one of my biggest disappointments is Javon Hargrave, the defensive tackle that we got from the Steelers. He just been kind of non-existent. Like you said, we didn't get a lot of preseason. He didn't get a lot of training camp with the new defense. But still, you put a lot of money into those defensive tackles. That's not the hardest job on defense.
Right.
So, you know, you expect him to come in, fill in, push the offensive line back, hold your ground. But once again, you know, similar to the Browns, our linebackers are – it's painful at times to watch them. You know, and our DBs aren't much better. We do have Darius Slay. Rodney McLeod at safety, he's played very well. But outside of that, it has been very shaky in the secondary even.
Yeah.
So that's kind of what I wanted to ask you. How confident are you in Baker in that passing game? Because I think Baker is still being criticized off of previous seasons rather than what's actually happened this season. Because if you look at his numbers, he's played, you know, pretty well. I mean, he's not costing you games, and he plays within the game plan.
Scotty, it's so funny with Baker because I think people want Baker to put up numbers like a number one overall pick.
Right. Right.
You know, well, you're the number one pick, so you got to throw for 400 yards a game.
Right.
You look at the weapons he's got. Well, you got Nick Chubb and Kareem Hunt.
Right.
You know, and you got a defense that's not great, so why wouldn't you want to run the ball, keep your defense off the field, you know, and let Baker pick his spots.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what he's been doing. And like you said, his numbers are pretty good.
Yeah.
You know, he's not a top five quarterback, but he doesn't need to be.
Yeah.
On this team. So, you know, I'm pretty happy with his progress. And Baker's just like the rest of the team. He's in his third season and he's on like his fourth or fifth coach. And he's had at least that many offensive coordinators too. So,
right.
So let him have some stability under one guy for a couple of years and see what happens.
Right. Yeah. He's a talented guy. And, you know, it's just funny, the criticism. Now, obviously Wentz gets his fair share and he's deserved it this year. But you look at him in respect to one another and you look at Baker compared to Wentz and you know Baker is just not costing you games at the end of the day, and with a running game and defense like that, you that's all you need at this point, you know. And then of course when you're in a tight situation, you just need Baker to make some good throws. So you know, looking at him in respect to Wentz, who has, you know, he leads the league in turnovers, so he's costing us games. So, you know, just looking at it from that perspective, you can't hate on Baker too much this season. I just almost feel like he's not getting enough credit for, you know, leading a 6-3 team. You know, I know it gets undershadowed by the running game, but there is a guy, you know, that's back there and he's controlling the helm. He's calling the plays and he's making the right decisions.
Well, Baker was getting a lot of criticism up through, We played too many games for me to remember all the games, Scotty, but you know, it was, well, he's beating the teams he's supposed to beat, you know, and then losing to, you know, and then he took the loss to the Ravens and Steelers. Well, you know, Baker's got to beat some of these teams to be good.
Right.
Okay. So that was the story. And then Baker, I can't even remember who the opponent was, but Baker had the game where he had 20 completions in a row. And people finally acknowledge, which set a team record.
Yeah.
Well, it was when he threw for 5 touchdowns. And he completed essentially his last 21 or 22 passes. He had a spike in there.
That's crazy.
And people finally started saying, you know, he looks pretty good. Maybe we'll get off his back for now.
Right.
So, There's just so much pressure on him to be just so great. And to me, it's really, really funny because you look at the history of what we've had at quarterback in Cleveland. And everybody knows about the jersey in Cleveland, how we've had, I'm exaggerating, but 95 different quarterbacks since, 1999.
Right.
And people want to, there was like this group of people that were like ready to move on from Baker. I'm like, who are you going to get? You think it's easy to just go out and grab another guy? We waited almost 20 years to find Baker.
Right.
What's
a guy.
Yeah. We just want a starting quarterback. Okay. Everybody's so worried about having a franchise and a top five guy and all this. Oh my gosh. You know how hard that is to do?
It's very hard.
Just because other teams are able to do it doesn't mean we can do it here. You just can't take for granted what you have.
Yeah.
So I'm pretty happy. I want to see, Baker's got, next season, and then the season after that is when he would have his fifth year option.
Gotcha.
So I'm more than happy to just watch him play this season and next season, and unless he really regresses, why wouldn't you keep him through his fifth year?
Yeah, like you said, quarterbacks don't grow on trees.
No, and, they don't.
I don't know why,
especially in Cleveland, why people would think that.
And that's, what I kind of try to tell, Eagles fans with Wentz is like, he's having his struggles this year. And obviously he gets criticized because of the injuries. But you kind of, after you give him that contract, we extended him. So you got to live with it. And, this is the first season I would say that Wentz has kind of sucked. And, the previous seasons, he's struggled with the injuries. Of course, everybody knows that around the league. But, he's been in the top tier of quarterbacks as far as his production when he plays. So that's why I'm not, giving up wins over one bad season. You know what I mean? So that's kind of where I'm at with him. But, just coming into the Browns and – I'm looking at Baker Mayfield in that offense and that running game. And basically what I'm thinking is, from an Eagles perspective, if I'm going into this game, it's our sole goal is to stop the run. We're going to be packing the box. That obviously we hope that we make Baker win the game. I think that's got to be the mindset coming into the game. Just how comfortable do you feel if it came down to that, if we somehow can control the run game or if we somehow could get a lead in the beginning and then you guys are playing from behind in some situation, how confident are you that Baker could go out and just win a game?
I have confidence in Baker, but I would have more confidence if you guys started trash talking him right now.
Right.
Because Baker plays better when he's got a chip on his shoulder.
Gets fired up.
When he gets fired up, that's when he comes out and completes every pass and he's got zip on his passes. When he's out there trying to be Mr. Nice Guy and make people happy, that's when he's overthrowing guys and stuff like that. So tell the media out there to get it going, make Baker mad.
It's funny because, Philadelphia has not been, trashing. I think we've been humbled. I think that's what's happened. And, Philadelphia is usually a pretty mouthy fan base. And we think we're the greatest thing in the world and all that jazz. But I think we've been humbled, especially, the last three seasons since winning the Super Bowl. It hasn't gone ideal. I mean, between injuries and now this season's just been a total disappointment.
You guys are still in first place, right?
Somehow.
That's
too bad. I guess the next, question would just be, how do you feel about the Eagles when you're looking at them, from an outside perspective? And maybe you're in the same situation as me as maybe you haven't watched them that much. Whatever the case may be, I guess what I'm trying to ask you is if you had a worry coming into the game, what would it be with the Philadelphia Eagles?
Well, let me tell you, when I think, and when the Browns fans think about the Eagles, here's the things they think about. First and foremost is the Carson Wentz trade.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, which has kind of faded a little bit since Baker's been around.
Yeah.
But, man, until Baker was drafted, that's all people want to talk about.
Yeah, because those Carson first Wentz two seasons, that second season by Wentz, obviously, you know, everybody's regretting not picking him at that point, but then, you know, yeah. It kind of trickles down as they keep playing.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's the first thing, you know, is the Carson Wentz trade. Second thing is, I know there's been a lot of injuries in Philly. I think you guys are getting more healthy.
Yeah.
So, correct. Know about the, like I said, great GM. And you guys are in first place.
Somehow.
So you're definitely playing for something, right? Yeah. It really doesn't matter what your record is if you're in first place. So to me, you can't just look at the record. You got to look at, you know, what the team's playing for. And the Eagles are you know, playing, trying to hang on to first place. And I look at the games. The Eagles have been in most of the games, and the Eagles played both the Steelers and the Ravens very tough. So I feel like the Eagles are better than their record. I really do.
Yeah.
So I just kind of feel like the Eagles and the coaches just kind of find a way to stay in games and kind of hang around. So that's kind of the main concern. I don't know if it's any one part of the team or anything. I just feel like for me to feel comfortable, the Browns would need to kind of put the game away early. Otherwise, it's probably going to be a close game most of the game.
And to your point, it's actually very great points about the Birds. You know, every game, I mean, probably besides that Rams game in week two, I think that was our only time that we, you know, actually lost by, you know, a comfortable margin for the Rams. But, you know, I think you're right as far as the resiliency. I think we've seen that since Doug Peterson became the head coach, is that, you know, yeah, he does have slow starts to games, to seasons, but he always finishes strong. And I think the same thing with Wentz. He gets really hot at the end of games. And the problem is that we put ourselves in holes, and then it's about if we can – you know, gain as much ground back as we've already given up, you know, if not more. You know, I guess the only thing that I would say that I would be concerned of as a Browns fan is the fact that the Eagles are coming off an embarrassing loss. You know, coming out of the bye week, you lose to a division rival who, you know, doesn't even have Saquon Barkley. You know, they have a brand new head coach. Yeah. And, you know, if there's one thing that Eagles fans thought before the season, it was that we would take care of our division at least. We're the only team with the same head coach from last season. You know, all other three teams got brand new head coach, brand new systems, and, you know, for the most part, brand new players. And, you know, to come out of a bye week and take that loss to the Giants, that one really stung. Doug Peterson came under fire this week. You know, he's people were calling for his job, believe it or not. And, you know, it was craziness. And,
people have short memories.
Yeah. It's all recency bias. And, you know, I guess the other way I'm looking at it as an Eagles fan is, you know, after the Browns, we have a streak of games against, the Seahawks, Packers, Saints, and Cardinals. We're you know, while I think we can compete with most teams, we could be looking at five losses in a row if we lose to the Browns. And, you know, obviously we think we have a chance against most teams, but, you know, that makes this Browns game, every game, week by week, just more and more important to us. And, you know, just coming off that loss, like you said, they're a resilient team. And, you know, even when they're beat up, they still find a way to compete. And I think that speaks a lot to the character, at least, you know. But I think that would be the one thing that would worry me about the Browns. And it's similar to what you were saying, just backs against the wall. You know, I know they call you guys the dog pound, but we have been some dogs these last years, you know, just grinding it out in November and December. But it's going to be an interesting game. And we don't play the Browns often. This might be our first time playing Baker Mayfield. I think this is the first time we played you guys since
feels like it's been
Carson's rookie year. And that's when RG3 started against us. So it's been a solid, you know, four seasons at least. So it should be a fun one. You know, maybe not fun for the, you know, average viewer, for fun for us. I think it's going to be a grinded out game. You guys play a gritty style. And I think we're going to have to match that if we want to stay in the game. I think we got to stick to the run. I think Doug, you know, he goes away from the run a little too easy for my liking, especially we got Miles Sanders. He's averaging 6.1 yards a carry right now. He's only getting around 14 or 15 touches, you know. And so that kills me. And you'll see a guy like Chubb get 20 carries, and then you'll see Kareem Hunt get close to 15 to 18 carries in the same game. And
they each had 18 carries last week.
Yeah, so you look at that, you guys are grinding it out, and I think that's the key to the success. I think teams with run games and defense, I think those are your keys to success. And if you look at our 2017 team, that was the recipe that we lived by. I know, you know, Nick Foles had his run and Carson Wentz did his thing that season, but we were grounded by a three-headed monster of LeGarrette Blount, Jay Ajayi, and Corey Clement. Mm-hmm. And, you know, since then, I think Doug just hasn't been willing to stick to the run. Last game, Miles gets 15 carries. I think we ran the ball 20 times and passed the ball close to 40. It was 37 passing attempts for Carson Wentz.
Yeah, that's too much.
And we're in our, as a team, we were averaging 6.3 yards a carry. So tell me why we're, you know, in a one-possession game, why we're not running the ball more. So what I'm hoping is that Doug, you know, comes out, he decides to stick to the run. Hopefully our defense shows up. They're so inconsistent. It's hard to say what defense will show up for us. But yeah, that's kind of my perspective going into that game. I think the Browns are on track, man. And I think you have stuff to be excited about. It's a young team. You got pieces in key places on the team. You know, you got a nice offensive line there. You got two good running backs that you got in contract. You got Baker in contract. Obviously, you got Landry and then Higgins with OBJ out right now. But, you know, you got guys out there. You got the two tight ends with Njoku and Hooper. And then, you know, I know you said on defense, not a bunch of star power aside from Myles Garrett and Denzel Ward, but those are two key spots, you know, for your future and building a base in the defense.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so
yeah, I
think you got a bright future. I guess kind of what I wanted to touch on before I get you out of here, just kind of what it's like, you know, one, losing a big piece like OBJ to the offense, who is your, you know, number one receiver. Maybe he wasn't always targeted like that, but he was probably your most talented receiver. And then, you know, getting a guy like Chubb back from injury and kind of what that was like without him.
Well, I mean, you know, the Browns are, you know, centered on the run, but I think Stefanski was really doing a good job of using OBJ properly.
I had him in
targeting him and you know, you guys in Philly, you know what trick plays are, and maybe you don't even like the word trick plays because they're designed plays, right? But,
right.
You know, he had a lot of run plays for OBJ that were successful. They were just trying to get him the ball more often and use his speed, and it was really working.
It was.
So, he wasn't getting a ton of touches each game, but I think when you have that threat out there, it definitely helps.
Works as a decoy sometimes.
He was on target for about 850 receiving yards this year. Not a ton of touchdowns. I think maybe 8 touchdowns is what he was on target for. So yeah, I mean it's a big loss, but the Browns have other guys, and guys have to step up. You know, just like exactly. I mean, happens in Philly. It needs to happen in Cleveland too. Yeah. So, but Jarvis has been banged up too. The tight ends have started to step up. You know, you got the two guys you mentioned, and Harrison Bryant's a young kid who who looks pretty talented.
Yeah, I was hearing a lot about him, you know, the weeks where Hooper was out. Yeah, he was really stepping up because I remember he was a big waiver wire guy in fantasy. And he had one really big game.
So
one or two games, yeah.
He's got a bright future. And getting Nick Chubb back, it's huge for the Browns. And they got Wyatt Teller back in the same game, who's their highest-rated offensive lineman, at right guard. And he's been playing extremely well this year. So in that game last week, Nick Chubb, probably his first 10 carries or so, he looked a little tentative. And then somewhere along the line, it changed.
He said, let's go.
He looked like the old Nick Chubb.
Right.
And so I think he's back. And it's huge for the Browns because Nick Chubb and Kareem Hunt are, they're not the same guy. They're just a little bit different. So the Browns like to start with Nick and kind of wear the other team down a bit. And then you put Kareem in fresh in the third and fourth quarter, good luck.
Right. Yeah, no.
That's the game plan.
And I think you're right, smack on the head right there. Hammer on the nail, right? So, because I just want to point this out, before I do get you out of here, that those running backs, while people may think that they're two different styles, which they are, I think Kareem Hunt's more of, he can be more of that receiving back, but they both bring that physicality and that punishing run style. Yeah. I mean, they finish their run strong. Absolutely. And that's what worries me.
Yeah, they can both carry some guys with them.
Yeah. So that's definitely what worries me going into this game. I guess before we get you out of here, let's get one prediction of the game for the game this Sunday. I'm sure you're taking the Browns. What score do you got for me?
Scotty, I always take the Browns, man.
I
don't care who they're playing. I always take the Browns. that this little stretch, I really thought that between I was kind of concerned between the Houston game and the Philly game. I thought, it'd be tough for the Browns to win both these games, and they played really well against Houston. I think this is going to be a closer game than people think. So, just because I think Philly is like you said, coming off that loss, and probably seeing the schedule ahead of them, even though they're not supposed to look at it.
You're not supposed to peek, but it's as well.
It'll depend on the weather. I mean, the weather's been a factor in Cleveland the last couple of weeks, but I think it's supposed to be maybe a little bit better this weekend. So, I'll take the Browns, but I'm going to say it's going to be something like 27-24.
Okay. Yeah, that's
– I think it'll be a close game.
That's similar along the lines that I was thinking as well. I'm a homer. I am. I'm biased, okay. I've seen us – I guess what it is that I've seen us win games that we're not supposed to before, previous years. And I think when our back's against the wall, Doug Peterson instills something in them that is kind of intangible, just a resiliency. But at the same time, I'm also realistic, and I know that there has to be a breaking point at some point with these seasons and, getting behind the ball and having to claw back every season at the end of the season. So it very well could be the turning point, for us if we do lose this game. Which all the more makes it a huge game for the Eagles. We need it. And I'm going to go ahead and give it to us. I'm not super confident. I'm not super confident that they will win. I'm being completely honest with you. I think the Browns have a recipe of play to where they can beat any team. I think when you run the ball and you don't make stupid decisions on defense, you play tough. And, I mean, believe it or not, people can say what they want about the Browns defense. I don't know a ton about the Browns defense. All I know is that they held, the Texans to 7 points last week, with Deshaun Watson-led offense. So it's going to be a tough game, and that's a tough defense. Myles Garrett is a game breaker. So it's going to be tough. I'm going to take the birds just because I'm a homer. And I'm going to take them 24-20, similar to your score. I don't think we'll get a ton of points out there. And obviously, I think the Browns will try to, you know, run it down our throats, which that'll kind of hamper the points a little bit as well. Ultimately, I think the difference is, even if we do get ran over, I think at some point in the game, Baker will have to make some throws that will kind of end the game. And I think it'll be dependent on that, you know, whether we're able to get pressure on Baker. And, you know, if Baker's just on that game, it may be a rough day for the Eagles. And I know Baker has his moments where he gets really hot. He can get out of the pocket, make some incredible throws, make some plays with his feet. So if he starts doing that on us on top of the run game, it might be a long day for us. So I think we just have to get out to a quick start because you do not want to get behind against that run game, man.
You're right. You never know which Baker's going to show up. For sure, not yet.
Not just yet.
We're still looking for that consistency.
But, you know, cheers. Hopefully you will get that consistency, just not this Sunday.
Starting to fall.
You know, cheers to the Browns, man. I appreciate you coming on the show, Rod. It was an awesome experience. And, you know, cheers to the Browns, you know, finally having some success. I think you guys, you know, you deserve it. You guys have grinded it out. Browns have a very loyal fan base. I mean, those games are generally sold out. I see the dog pound every Browns game that I watch. So much respect to you for hanging in there. And, you know, you're finally reaping the benefits. And, you know, thank you for coming on the show. I'll go ahead and shout you out again with your podcast. Be sure, guys, I know not a lot of Browns fans listen to my show, but still, be sure to go over and give Rod a nice subscription. Over on Apple Podcasts. I saw that it's out on that streaming site, the Browns Blitz. If you need to know anything about Cleveland, just go check out my guy, Rod. Give him a subscription. Give him a nice review. And just be sure to check out his stuff. Give him a follow on Twitter, at the Browns Blitz. That's with a Z at the end. And then you can also find Rod's personal account at CleRod, capital B. So that is CLEROD, capital B. And then if there's anything else that you want to shout out, Rod, before I let you go, thank you for coming on the show, man. I appreciate you a lot.
Thanks, Scotty. It's been great talking to you. And pretty much everything's on my Twitter account and on that Browns Blitz page. So I always like interacting with anybody who wants to check it out.
Awesome, Rod. Well, thank you, brother, once again. And good luck. Let's hope for no injuries. That's always the main thing. You know, keep our teams healthy going forward. And let's just hope for a good game, buddy.
Sounds good to me.
Thanks for coming on, Rod. That's going to be it for the show, guys.